Dragon's Breath Cavern by Embarrassed Composer. This marks the start of my documentation of my exploration of one of the largest underground lakes in the world that we know of so far. I'm an ichthyologist, and I've been doing research in this field for quite a few years now, traveling whenever my limited budget has allowed me. I started off with marine biology in the beginning of my career, but I discovered I was much more interested in the fish themselves than the ecosystem in its whole. I started traveling for personal research in my mid-20s, and alongside that, I had to become well-versed in caving and diving along the way. It was unbelievable how adaptive fish can be, from lungfish that live in the dry earth for up to a few years without water, and when the rain finally comes, they emerge from the ground, to the countless species living in the Mariana Trench, withstanding thousands of times our atmospheric pressure in the eternal darkness. It was during one of my trips to Africa that I heard about this lake. They called it Dragon's Breath. I was intrigued right away, just with the name alone. I asked a few local tour guides if they were familiar with it. Most of them didn't know much until I met a guide who was born and raised in Namibia and had himself been curious about the cavern. He had never been there himself, but he knew of a few guides who are said to have been there and were leading expeditions there. I decided that my next trip would be to the Dragon's Breath. A few months later, I had done my research. I had contacted multiple people from the area. Finding someone who was willing to take me and a couple of others wasn't exactly an easy task, and this would be by no means an inexpensive trip, but nevertheless, I had to go. We needed a couple of guides and two off-road vehicles equipped to the teeth, a couple of small boats, a lot of gear, diving, climbing, and caving gear. I knew the cave had a very rare species of catfish. To be exact, the golden catfish, one of the rarest species of fish in the world, and isolated to that single cave. The cave lay 330 feet below the surface, and the few divers who have gone there have dived over 400 feet in the cave without seeing any bottom inside. The cave was originally found in 1986 by explorers like myself. And they named the cavern Dragon's Breath because of the humid air rising from the small opening of the cave. It was much larger than they originally expected, about 4.9 acres to be somewhat exact. When we arrived in town, just about an hour or so drive from where we were heading, it was blazingly hot in the midday sun. Me and my travel partners, two other biologists, another ichthyologist, and a biospeleologist. I had been to Africa a few times before, as I mentioned, but you never get used to the heat. It's so hot that you could see faint lines dance over every surface as heat radiated off of them. We soon found the place where we were supposed to meet our guides. Two men stood in the shade of a canopy hanging off the side of a building. I walked towards them as they stared at me, almost expectantly. I cleared my throat as I got to them. "Excuse me. Are you the guides for the Dragon's Breath expedition?" I asked slightly sheepishly, realizing I had never gotten their names. The men nodded and walked towards me. "We are. Are you Bernard?" the older man said. I nodded and stood there for a moment, gathering my train of thought. I was too excited and didn't really know where to begin. I was brimming with questions. "We go tomorrow, in the morning, before sunrise. Out by sunset," he said before I could even get anything out. "May I ask your names?" I blurted out. Apparently, formalities had been foregone in this situation. "I'm Jephthah, and this is David." He pointed at the younger man who was with him, who had a softer expression than Jephthah. And Jephthah was a no-nonsense type of guy, it seemed. He was matter-of-fact and went over the plan with us. He didn't give us much room for questions, and as the day passed, he informed us that we would be camping in the desert for the night to utilize our time there as well as we could. The drive was rather uneventful, and setting up camp went smoothly. We sat under the stars and ate our dinner. "Have you been to the caves often before?" I asked Jephthah, who was going over the different equipment we had to carry into the cave. "A few times. There's a lot of work in it, and it isn't very safe. We shouldn't be there more than a few hours. He was still working swiftly, with precise movements. He had done this more than a few times, I would wager. Caving was never really safe, especially diving in them, so I wasn't surprised. He probably didn't want to press his luck. The morning came. The dark sky was lightening rapidly as we all piled into the trucks and started heading towards the cave's mouth. We had reached it by sunrise. As the sun climbed into the sky, it turned bright pink. I set off to offer my assistance to David, who was hauling ropes and ties and rappelling gear. He smiled and shook his head. Jephta is particular with how he wants his things set up. Just look around while we finish getting ready, he said. So we did. I talked with Hansen, the other ichthyologist, about how excited we were to dive and see the golden catfish. Meanwhile, Chris, the biospeleologist, was trotting around the entrance, but not too close. He was inspecting the plant life and peering into the mouth to see what he could, and of course, he was taking photo after photo. Jephta called to us, and we all gathered around the surprisingly small opening. I had imagined a gaping maw, but it was fairly standard, I suppose. We put on our harnesses. The uncomfortable snugness against my thighs giving me no comfort as we were about to descend. I steadied myself on the edge, all tied up and ready to go, and I slowly leaned back into the harness, feeling gravity pulling at my heels. My heart fluttered a bit as a warm, humid wind swept up from below. It felt as if the cavern was breathing, and I understood where it got its name from. The strange feature of the entrance was that there were two ledges you had to traverse first before making a descent of 100 feet. I nervously slid down the first two ledges, and standing on the second one, I stared down at Jephta below in one of the two rubber dinghies in the water. Two large floodlights illuminated a fair bit of the cavern, but far from all of it. As I started down the last drop, the cave below started opening up into a cavernous room, which I could barely see all of. The water was still and the air felt almost thick. My clothes started to cling to my body from the moisture in the air. Hansen, Chris, and David soon followed after me, Chris taking the longest as he was photographing nearly every crack and crevice of the place. As David rappelled down, Jephta took to gathering up the wetsuits and other necessary equipment. I took off the harness, then my pants, and laid them on the small bench in the back of the boat. The dinghy rocked as David dropped the last couple of feet and I stood unsteady in the small boat for a minute. He grinned and tied the rappelling rope to the first dinghy as I, Jephta, and Hansen sat in the second one squeezing into the wetsuits. One of the floodlights pointed into the water, illuminating part of it. I could see at least 20 feet down and I saw movement down below in the otherwise still water. I had been diving countless times, but never in a cave like this. I was a bit unsettled. The warm air didn't feel all too comforting. It almost pulsed, and I just put it down to being further underground than I was used to. I glanced at Hansen, and he seemed a bit unnerved as well. Meanwhile, Chris was rearing for us to get into the water so him and David could row around the cave and document it further, and see what kind of life inhabited the inside of this huge cave. The oxygen tank was heavy on my back. The boat rocked precariously as we got onto the edge and prepared to fall backwards into the water. Don't go where you can't see, and try to stay within the light. I will lead you to the fish. Getting lost is very easy in here, so be close. Jephta spoke as we were fitting our respirators into our mouth. I nodded. Hansen bobbed his head twice and fiddled with the strap on his chest. You two go first. I'll be right after you. Keep your lights on at all times. It gets dark fast. After that, Jephta popped his own respirator into his mouth. The water was almost surprisingly cool compared to the warm humidity above. It took me a minute to orientate myself, and I saw Hansen scanning the water beside me. Then Jephta joined us with a burst of bubbles erupting around him. He pointed in front of him, and we both nodded. The bubbles streamed around us as we descended further into the water. The floodlights on the boats grew dimmer the further we went. Soon the water was only lit by our own flashlights, glowing eerily, debris and sand getting kicked up by our flippers as we passed through the water. Suddenly, something small and yellow swam slowly by us, and I excitedly flailed and pointed towards the small, almost alien-looking creature lazily swimming by. Hansen, by then, had noticed it. Soon more swam into sight, and I followed them, all swimming in the same direction. They swam around in a small alcove that had about 24 of them slowly swimming around, feeling around with their long whiskers. After a few minutes, I went a little deeper and found the floor of the alcove. I curiously poked at something sticking out of the sediment. It looked like a bone. Well, this is after all called a fossil cave. Whatever poor creature that had fallen into here would be trapped until it drowned, only then to be eaten by the small inhabitants that could swim or fly. I waved my hand over it, kicking up a small cloud of dust around me, turning my visibility to almost nothing for a moment. It wasn't just a bone. It was an entire skeleton. Almost. It seemed to be some kind of mammal, not a human. But it was a little bit odd, nonetheless. There was something about it, though. It seemed to have had some fractured bones, and some were missing, others looking worse for wear. I guessed that it had probably gotten injured as it fell into the maw of the dragon's breath. But the truly odd thing is how deep the alcove was. How did the bones get so deep into this small little offshoot? There wasn't a viable current. I shrugged. It probably just swam until it couldn't anymore, and it ended up here. I scratched my head, and then realized with a startle that I had forgotten to keep an eye on Jephta and Hansen. I whirled around, only to see my own flashlight beam, but not theirs in the increasingly murky water, which had once been clear. I swam out of the alcove. I had gone further than I intended to in my excitement. As I swam back into the open water, I could faintly see the beam of a flashlight in the water. I hurriedly swam towards it. But it seemed to get further away the further I went. There it was again, that feeling of unease. There was something about being so deep underground, in the water. The water almost seemed to thrum around me as I kept swimming to the ever-dimming light. I started to feel the dread for real when I couldn't even spot the beam that I had just seen minutes earlier. Then I decided to surface. At least I could find my bearings again and hopefully find David. I looked at my gauge to check my oxygen levels. They were still fine. This was intended to be a 3-hour dive. As I began to ascend, I felt the pressure lessening, and I didn't feel as unsettled anymore. I guess a thing with fresh water is that you aren't as buoyant as you are in salt water, and so you sink deeper and faster than you think. Because of this, it was taking me a while to get to the surface, and I was starting to feel a bit of a strain as I kept swimming briskly, expecting to break the surface at any moment. But there was something that wasn't right. When did it get so murky? The visibility went from 20 feet to almost none in what I guessed was less than 20 minutes. I couldn't have been in the water much longer than that at this point, but the ever-creeping fear made it feel almost like hours. I've never been afraid of the water. In fact, I loved it. But at that moment, being alone in this underground abyss felt suffocating, rather than the usual peaceful drift. And then I realized I was drifting. There had been a current, after all, deeper in the cave, but it was so consistent that I hadn't noticed it. And the pressure had started to push on me because I was a lot deeper than I accounted for. I kept swimming upwards steadily, and as I did, my ears started to feel the pressure difference. Looking upwards, pointing my flashlight beam forward as I swam and swam and swam for what felt like an eternity. It's like in a dream, when you need to run, but you can't. I started to see movement in the water, like the current was changing, but I still felt the slight downwards pull of the current. Then something large, at least a few feet long, swam just outside of the beam of my flashlight, and I stupidly froze. The current began dragging me back into its clutches. A cloud of bubbles rose from my respirator and got pulled down, reminding me that I had to keep swimming. The burst of bubbles became more frequent and erratic as I started to panic a bit more. I was seeing movement everywhere. I swam hard and fast. I probably shouldn't have, because the next thing I knew, I rammed my head into the top of the alcove. My vision went dark for a moment. A red cloud bloomed around me. My light was dangling from the strap on my arm. I again began to fade into the darkness. The next thing I know, I'm lying on the floor of a small offshoot. There are small fish swimming around me slowly in the barely lit water. My flashlight is laying half-covered in the sediment on the floor. Something long and dark swam above my head in the shadows of the water. It was a lot longer than a few feet. Panic fluttered in my chest again. I scrambled awkwardly, kicking up a cloud of debris and sediment as I tried to figure out which way I should go. Hadn't I been facing the other way when I came in here? Or had I kept going further into the alcove instead of exiting it? Had I gotten turned around at some point? I didn't know. I started forward, and just as I did, something brushed against my flipper, tugging it slightly. The water began to thrum once again, almost feeling like there was static in it. I started to swim harder, kicking up clouds behind me. The water felt bizarre. It almost crackled as I swam through it, desperate to get out. A burst of bubbles startled me as I exhaled, and I slowed my pace a bit, aware of the fact that I had been underwater for a while, and that I now had no way of measuring it. I had originally intended to rely on Jephta for it, and the depth gauge. The only thing I had was the oxygen meter, so I checked it. I was still good. I had half a tank, although that meant that I had been under the water for a substantial amount of time. We had agreed to have an extra hour and a half on the tanks if need be. I once again paused. I didn't feel the current anymore. The water started clearing up more. The golden catfish occasionally floated by as I kept a steady pace. The water was still dark and slightly cloudy. I noticed a slight hum starting to grow behind me. The water rippled almost. A voice in my head screamed at me to keep swimming, no matter how much my head hurt or how much my calves screamed in protest. Then I felt the tug of a cramp forming in my calf, and I swore silently to myself as I started to slow down. The hum grew louder, vibrating the water around me. It felt like I had been thrown into an ice bath. The water around me started pulling back at me. Then it pushed me forward, in intervals, almost like something was breathing. It grew slightly stronger. Then the tunnel I was swimming through narrowed. It narrowed considerably. It was still pretty wide. There were more catfish here. It was almost familiar. The water was almost clear, and I noticed a familiar pile of bones at the bottom, and I managed to get through the mouth of the alcove and shot into the calm waters. The hum faded. I could see the small fish still getting dragged and pushed by the odd current, slowly being pulled deeper into the long, deep alcove, which probably wasn't one after all. It was probably a tunnel, further and deeper into the cave. I looked around me. I could see the faint floodlights above, and I pulled at the water with my hands, letting the flashlight dangle around my wrist as I pushed forwards towards the surface. When I broke it, I spat out my respirator and gave a disgruntled scream, hurrying up to the dinghy where David, Hansen, and Chris stood, frozen with what looked like terror. They scrambled to pull me aboard, and David flashed the floodlight signaling Jephta to surface. He looked grim as he pulled himself into the boat, but he said nothing. They pulled the gear off of me as I laid at the bottom of the boat, exhausted, panting and weeping. I felt pressure and a sting on my head, and David mumbled an apology. "What happened to you? You were there one moment and then gone the next. I was right behind you the entire time. Then it was like you had vanished," Hansen asked as he stood over me. He was pale and panicked. "I'm not sure. I was just studying the fish when I noticed some animal bones on the floor of the alcove that we had swum into. Hansen abruptly cut me off. Alcove? There was no alcove. We were in open water. His tone grew more and more worried. I just followed them for a few feet. It couldn't have been more than that. Unless the current had already started pulling me, I said breathlessly. There was no current, Bernard. What are you talking about? Hansen looked confused as he said that. There was. I didn't notice it to begin with, but after being pulled into this alcove and then trying to get out and heading the wrong direction, I seemed to be in a tunnel. The water was almost black aside from the light I saw, and I followed it, assuming it was you. I began to calm down, but my head still throbbed. Jephta sat in the second boat and was peeling his wetsuit off with the same grim look over him. I told you to stay close to me. This cave has many secrets it will not tell. It's old as the earth itself, and maybe home to something greater than ourselves. He spoke coldly. I groaned as I raised myself up, looking at Jephta. Whatever's down there, I don't want to know. It was enough experiencing it once, I said harshly and winced as a wave of pain shot through my head. The group was quiet after that. David ascended first, then hauled most of the equipment up, before Hansen and Chris followed. Then they began to pull me up. As I was being pulled up, I looked down and watched Jephta. And in the dark waters below the dinghy, I swear that I could see long dark shadows slowly writhing in the water, dwarfing the small boat considerably. I didn't look back down after that. I found out as we sat above the cave that they had been searching for me for almost 4 hours. Jephta and David heaved the last dinghy over the edge of the small cave opening. I sat there as my head was being wrapped in dry bandages, although my hair was still slightly damp. I had a headache, still reminding me of the terror I had felt in those tunnels. It's been a while since then. I still can't go into dark water, and I mostly stick to anything that's going to keep me away from water at all, ironically. I work as a professor, teaching other bright-eyed and enthusiastic biologists who are itching to explore and uncover new species. I don't discourage them, but I will not mention dragon's breath to them, or to anyone else for that matter. To my knowledge and best guesses, due to this being such a hazardous place to explore, a lot of it has been uncharted. There are possibly hundreds of tunnels, alcoves, whatever you want to call them in there. And they have things that we can't imagine because nature is made to adapt. And whatever poor creature ends up in that water will perish. It just remains to be guessed if the water or something else claimed them.